today I want to take a few minutes, and I just really feel in my heart that where we're at as a nation, where we're at in our community, where we're at individually, even the state of the church and the things that are going on in our earth today, there are so many fears. There's so many uncertainties. A lot of people deal with anxiety and different things in their life, but there is a comfort in knowing that what God has promised is true. There's a comfort in knowing that no matter the circumstances we're facing and the things that may be going on in our life, that there is a principle from the Word of God, and there is a God in heaven whose promises are yes and amen. There is something comforting knowing that even though my flesh and my emotions may be screaming one thing, that if I can get myself back centered on the Word of God and the promises of God, and if I can continue to sow the seed, which is the word that we talked about last week, and continue to sow the seed will multiply and the seed will meet the need. Come on now, the seed will meet the need. And last week we talked about that in all reality, the identity is not in the soil. Now, Jesus talked about the soil in the parable of the sower, but we put an emphasis on the seed last week because the seed is important. And of course, the soil is important, but the reality is the identity is in the seed. The identity is not in the soil. Your soil may be messed up this morning. You may have some rocks in it. You may have some issues in it. You may have some things going on in your soil. But I'm here to tell you, if you will get the right seed in your soil, the seed of the Word of God and the fruit of that seed will begin to cause all other things that are in your soil to be pushed out in Jesus' name. And if we understand, as we talked about last week, the identity is in the seed. And we talked about that if there is an area in your life that you are deficient, you need to grab hold of heaven's seed and you need to begin to sow it into the place of your heart. And you need to begin to not only quote that word, but you need to begin to live that word. When we wrapped up the sermon last week, that's what we talked about, that there's a lot of people that can quote the word but never see the fruit in their life, and the reason being is because we never get it in our heart. Somebody shout heart. We never get it into our heart because when it's in our heart, we actually live it out and walk it out. Because the Bible says that out of the heart flow the very issues of life. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And when we get our heart full of the seed of the Word of God, the seed from heaven, it begins to produce in our life. And there is identity in the seed. And if you need, listen, if you need financial breakthrough and blessings in your life, you've got to learn to sow the seed of the financial state that you may be in. And you may say, hey, I don't really have a lot to give. It's not about how big you give. It's not about how much you give. It's about your obedience in giving. There's a story in the Bible about a woman that only had two mites. She didn't have a lot, but she sowed what she had, and when she did, God blessed her life. Now, as I was praying about teaching on this principle of first this morning, it's always, not for every pastor, but for me, sometimes it's a struggle because there's two things that I need to let you know. Number one, I'm not interested in you giving more money. If you give more money, your life will be blessed, this ministry will be blessed, and the kingdom of God can advance. Don't hear me wrong. But I'm not trying to teach a message or teach something to get something. Actually, God is not trying to get something from us, and I want you to know, as a pastor, I'm not trying to get something from you. I'm trying to get something to you. And there is a principle that when you begin to sow in whatever area it is in your life, that you will begin to reap in that area. It's a principle in the Word of God. And so number two is this: I'm not going to be teaching this message this morning because we're in any financial trouble. I want to take just a moment and give glory to God that Revive Church is in a healthy financial state in the midst of all the things that's going on in the earth today. To God be the glory. We humbly thank you, Lord, that you are blessing our life individually and corporately in a time where churches have had to shut down. Father, thank you for your faithfulness and your blessing. And I'm not preaching this because we are in a financial hardship or anything else, but I believe that there is a true enemy out there, that people, even in the church, that call themselves Christians are retreating instead of running to the battle. I believe that there are Christians in this hour that are retreating and not walking in all that God has for them because of fear. Now, I'm not talking about being cautious. I'm not talking about having some common sense and washing your hands. And if you are sick, not going around other people. Those are important things that we need to do, that we don't need to go to work if we're sick. We don't need to come to church if we're sick and this and that. You don't know to need to go visit grandma or your mother or all these kind of things until your symptoms leave. I'm not talking about being irrational or not having some common sense, but what I'm saying and sensing and seeing that there are a lot of Christians that are retreating from the battle that we're in, and now is the time that we begin to take the kingdom by force, because the kingdom of God suffers violence, but the violent take it by force. So what am I saying today? We need to get our spirits stirred up instead of being oppressed by the media, instead of being oppressed by COVID-19, instead of being oppressed by the fear and the things that are going on in the world today. This is the hour for the church to be who God has called her to be. This is time for the church to get up off of our pews and get into the streets and get into the place that God has called us to be. This is the time that we need to be getting up and not waiting for a corporate organization of an outreach, which we need to be having more of those, but we need to be individuals that are in the streets declaring the goodness of God, that God is the cure, that God is the answer, that God will do the impossible in our life. It is time for the church to be who God has called her to be. And not only are people retreating and people are not walking in their calling and their destiny, but in a time when we're facing uncertainties, thank the Lord, as I already said, we are blessed and this house is blessed corporately. And God, by your mercy and grace, you will always supply all of our needs according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. We put our trust in you. But a lot of people during the month of December, they have to put their Christmas gifts on a credit card. Don't do that. Now, I'm not condemning you if you do and telling you you're a bad person, but what I'm telling you is you're going to have a heartache and a headache come January when you have to pay for all this stuff that your kids done threw to the side. And what our kids need more than anything is relationship with us. And they like the gifts too, But what I know is that even during this time, and even with the uncertainty that's going on in the world today, and even the rise of sickness and COVID cases spiking, and what's going to happen with my job, and what's going to happen here, and what's going to happen with this and that, that sometimes we can draw back and hold back from the Lord, even in the area of finances. And that's one of the most dangerous things that we can do, because if we're not sowing seed, if we're not putting God first in our finances, then we're not putting our faith and trust in Him. And if we don't put our faith and trust in Him, where are we putting our faith and our trust? Because the reality is, God's economy never suffers. It never, ever suffers. You look throughout the Bible, even in times of famine, God's people were taken care of. Was there times of leanness? Were there times that maybe you can't buy a $5 cup of coffee? Well, maybe that might happen and maybe that might come. But listen, if you are in covenant with God and you are in covenant with Him with your finances, God will always make sure you are taken care of. We see it all throughout the Bible. And as I was thinking about this principle, the principles of the Word of God, and even this concept of sowing seed, today I want to talk briefly about this principle of first. Because a lot of times people can argue over whether the tithe is under the law, over the law, not the law. I don't have to do that. I'm exempt from it and everything else. And I've had people disagree with me about tithing and different things. And listen, I don't get mad and kick them out of the church or make them feel less than or anything else. This word and this message is not a message of condemnation. It's actually a message of freedom. It's actually a message of freedom. And God desires to set us free in every area, and He also desires to set us free from financial stress. Financial stress will kill a marriage. Come on now, financial stress will kill a marriage. A financial stress will kill your joy. It will kill your peace. Financial stress will cause you to have ulcers. Financial stress will cause you to lose sleep. Financial stress has caused people to lose their minds. That even when you study from history and you study even the Great Depression and recessions and things like that, that people would literally take their life because of financial stress. There is a reason that in the New Testament, the Bible deals with finances and possessions more than anything else, more than prayer, more than faith, because if we don't get that part of our life right in a world that we live in today, if we don't understand that we cannot serve both God and mammon, if we don't get that and understand that, the financial stresses and the things of this society will try to kill and rob and steal every area of our life. We see it all throughout. We see it all throughout life. We see it all throughout the Bible. And God desires to set us free from financial stress. And can I say this? Financial lack. God is not a God of lack. He is more than enough. And He desires for us to walk in all the blessings that He has already purchased for us. And I begin to ask myself as a young Christian, why do some people walk in the blessings and other people don't walk in the blessings? And the only thing, and there's a lot of people a lot smarter than me, but one thing that I see all throughout the Bible is that those who obeyed the Lord, those who obeyed His word, the blessings of the Lord always overtook them. It's one thing to love the Lord, but it's another thing to obey the Lord. There's a lot of people that say, oh yes, I love the Lord. And I believe that there's a lot of people that confess that they really do. But Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. He said, if you really love me, you will keep my commandments. And what we have to do is we have to begin to get in alignment in every area of our life with the Lord. We have to get in alignment with His word. And your preferences, listen, your preferences and my preferences can cause us to miss the blessings of God. Your preferences and my preferences can cause us to miss, listen to this, it can cause us to miss God's provision for our life. God is the source. And He is the provider of our life. You may say, well, you don't know my criminal record, and you don't know this, and I've got this mark and that mark and everything else, but I'm telling you, there is a God that can make a way where there seems to be no way. I'm here to tell you that you may say, well, I wasn't born with a silver spoon in my mouth, and I don't have the education, and I don't have the smarts, and I wasn't voted most likely to succeed, but can I tell you something? That even when Joshua took over for Moses, the word of the Lord said, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that's written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous. Come on, that's not a dirty word. Say it with me, prosperous. God wants us to prosper. He said, then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. He didn't say that you had to be a certain ethnicity. He didn't say you had to be born in a certain country. He didn't say you had to be of a certain tribe or a certain tongue. He said, no, if you will meditate on this word, if you will continue to speak it, if you will walk it out, then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. It's amazing that our preferences can cause us to miss the provision of God, and there is a principle all throughout the Bible called the principle of first. It's the principle of first. All the way from Genesis to Revelation, you can see woven through there that there is this principle of first, and there's something about people that want to be first. First in line, who wants to stand at the back? Come on, you go to the drive-thru, you want to be the first one there. You want to be the first one out the door. I wish everybody wanted to be the first one to get to church on Sunday morning. I wish everybody was like, man, I'm going to be the first one to prayer. The first face the pastor sees is going to be mine. What if everybody did that? You'd have a happy pastor. Not that I'm unhappy, I'm just saying. You would have a happy pastor. Woo, here they come. Instead of pastors be peeking out the window, who's going to show up today? Who's going to show up today? Who's going to show up today? All this kind of stuff. But the principle of first, there's something about wanting to be first. You remember when you were on the playground and they were going to pick teams? You never wanted to be last. You wanted to be first. You wanted to be first. First one out the door in the parking lot. God wants to be first. Let me say it again. God wants to be first. He wants to be first in all of our lives. And there is a reason why God wants to be first. See, all first things belong to God. They belong to God. We must understand that. The hours of the day, the first hours of the day, belong to God. They belong to God. The day of the week, this is the first day of the week. It belongs to God. You are sitting here. You are joining online. Why? Because we want to honor God the first day of the week. We want to come together corporately. We want to bring our financial gifts. We want to bring our physical gifts. We want to bring our supply of the Spirit together with the household of God. A lot of people in this hour and this day don't see the importance of the local church anymore. Thank God for online services. Thank God that people can join us that can't be here today. For those of you that need to quarantine and those of you that are sick, thank God that we have the technology, that there can still be a connection through technology, but there is no substitution for the gathering of the local church. What God is doing in the earth today, He is doing it not through a one-man show, not through a preacher that's got bling and everything else. What God is wanting to do today, and has always been wanting to do since Jesus ascended, is to empower the local body of Christ to go forward, to lay hands on the sick, to see them recover, to cast out enemies and demons, and to see the recovery of sight to the blind. What God wants to do, He does it through the local church. That is you and I. The local church has always been under attack. I believe that even today it's under even a greater attack, that people don't see the importance of us coming together on the first day of the week together to honor God together, to bring our offerings, to bring our tithe, and to be encouraged and strengthened and to build relationships so that when we go outside these walls, we are being who God has called us to be. God, in all that we are, wants our first. He don't want our last. He don't want our leftover. He wants our first. He wants the first of all of our increase. We read this scripture a lot, but I'm going to read it this morning. It's in Proverbs 3, 9, and 10. It says this: honor the Lord with your possessions. Honor the Lord with your possessions. Everything that we have, not just our finances, everything that we have, we're to honor the Lord. Have you ever thought about it? With our cell phone, we need to honor the Lord with it. A lot of people dishonor the Lord with it. Come on. Everything that we have, I remember when I was a youth pastor, I used to teach our teenagers that everything that you have, God wants you to honor Him with it. If you've got a car, God wants you to honor Him with it. If you've got some lunch money, God wants you to honor Him with it. He don't want you to take that lunch money and try to get something that you ain't supposed to be buying with that money. God wants you to honor Him with everything that you have, and God wants us to honor Him with all of our possessions, and look what He says, and with the first fruits of all your increase. The first fruits of all your increase. Why? Here's the promise that God gives us. If you do this, so that your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. See, when we honor God with our possessions, when we honor God with our life, when we honor God with our words, when we honor God with our finances, when we honor Him, He says that when we honor Him with the increase in our life, our barns will be filled with plenty and our vats will overflow with new wine. And see, how do you honor God? You honor God in so many different ways, but one of the greatest ways to honor God is by returning back to Him what belongs to Him. When you return back to God what belongs to Him, when you put God first and you give Him the first of all your life, when you make God first, because the Bible says, and actually not the Bible, but Jesus told us in Matthew 6:33, seek ye first. Somebody shout it, first. The kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all things shall be added unto you. Listen, when God is not first, we are out of order. When God is not first in our marriage is out of order. When we put our kids above our spouse, our marriage is out of order. Come on, there's been people that worship their kids, and marriage relationship suffers. God should be first. God is always first. It is God first. And when God is not first, things are out of order. And when there's no order, there's what? There's chaos. There's chaos. Why is there chaos in families? Why is there chaos in communities? It's because God is not first. What have we been doing for months through a pandemic and election year? We've been trying to call the church back to the altar, back to the place of prayer, back to the place of repentance, back to the place of putting God first. Because that is the formula. It is not a better degree. Yes, it's okay to get a better degree and a better job. The solution is not money and things. The solution is not the right politicians or the right president. The solution is not the things of this world. The solution is the church of Jesus Christ putting him first in every area of their life. The solution to a community and even a nation being healed is for the church to come back to the place of prayer and come back to putting God first in every area of their life. And that includes finances, relationships with our children, with our ministries. Come on, sometimes our ministries get exalted above the Lord. I'm here to tell you that this house shall be a house where God is first. Not the preacher, not the pastor, not the music, not the decor, not the lights, not the parking lot, not the sound, not this, not that. No, God should be first in everything that we do. Not our ideas, not our ministry programs, not our outreach plans or purposes or anything else. We must be a house where God is first in everything. Come on, if you're with me, give God some praise right now. First in everything, because when we put God first in our marriage, when we put God first in our job, when we put God first in our ministry, when we put God first in our finances, we begin to flow in this order of God that brings freedom and abundance into our life. It is supernatural. See, some people pray and some people fast and they never get breakthrough because they don't obey the word of the Lord. Listen, I believe in laying hands on the sick. I believe in calling on the elders of the church to pray. I believe in anointing with oil. I believe in the full gifts of the Spirit. But come on, I've said this before. You can have as much oil rubbed on your head as a piece of greasy fried chicken, but if you don't walk in the principles of God, you're not going to get a breakthrough. You can have prayer partners, prayer chains. You can have somebody hand you a handout to get you over a hump, but that hump is coming right back up until you begin to obey the principles in the Word of God. I can't tell you how many people that come to the door asking for help and needing help. And I can't tell you over a span of period that the same people come back over and over and over again until I make them mad and run them off. Not intentionally, but I sit down and say, listen, I can help you get a hotel room for one night, but what are you going to do tomorrow? I can help you get some food for the week, and I'll be happy to help you get some food for the week, but let's talk about what's going on in your life. Let's talk about the plan and the purpose of God for you, because the plan and the purpose of God is to give you a hope and a future and to prosper you. And if you're not walking in that, I want to help you. And it begins by surrendering your life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Well, I'm saved and churches don't help nobody else no more. Boom, walk out the door and everything else. Some people just don't want help. Why am I saying all that? Because I'm saying this, that there is nothing in life that can help us, and there's nothing in life that can cause us to flow in the provision that God has for us apart from obeying Him and walking in His Word and walking in His principles. And so God wants to set us free in every area. And when it comes to this thing of finances, so many people struggle financially. They struggle and they have the stress of financing, of finances, but there is this principle of first, of putting God first in our finances. Not putting our children first, not putting our Christmas list first, it's putting God first in every area, especially in the place of our finances. And when we return back to God what belongs to Him, there is a blessing that flows from heaven. It's a principle all throughout the Bible, not just when we say the word tithe, but when we say this principle of first. And when you go and you look at this thing of tithing in Malachi chapter 3, I actually gave you guys verse 10, but I'm actually going to begin in verse 8. It says this, will a man rob God? Malachi 3, verse 8, yet you have robbed me, but you say, in what way have you robbed me? It says, in tithes and offerings. He says, because you have robbed me, you are cursed with a curse. Now, I'm not a pastor that preaches curses. Are there curses out there? Absolutely. Are there generational curses? Absolutely. Is there a process from the Word of God to break generational curses and begin generational blessings in your life? Absolutely. I am a product of that. Thank the Lord, only by His grace. But there is a curse that we operate under the curse when we don't walk in the Word and the promises and the principles of God. There's a curse, but guess what? Jesus redeemed us from the curse. He redeemed us from the curse. And He says that, have you robbed me? He says, in tithes and offerings, you're cursed with the curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. He says this, here's how you're going to break this. It says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts. He says, try me now in this. If I will not open up the windows of heaven, if I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessings that there will not be room enough to receive it. And He goes on to say, I will even do this. I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. I will rebuke the devourer for your sake so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground. He will not destroy the fruit of your ground. Nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And all the nations will call you blessed, for you will be a delightful land, says the Lord of hosts. You know, there's been so much controversy about the tithe. People leave churches over the tithe. Let me tell you that it works both ways, that there are people that have been beat up from pastors about the tithe. I don't beat people up about the tithe. I teach what I believe the Scripture says is true. And there have been people that argued and said, you are not preaching that right and teaching that right because we're not under the law and the tithe was under the law. But whenever I study the Scripture about the principle of first, that grace is so much greater than even the law, that even if you do, if you think the tithe is under the law is easier than grace, because under grace, we're really supposed to be selling everything that we've got and taking care of each other's needs. Come on, we're really under grace, we're really supposed to say, yeah, here's the key to my house. Anytime you need it, come and get it, you know. We're not supposed to be allowing people to abuse the things of God, but under grace, even Jesus said, you have heard it said that you shall not murder someone, but if you even have hatred in your heart, you've already done it. There is something greater than the law. It is grace. It is a power in God's life, but there is this principle of first, of return the first back to God, that brings a tremendous blessing into our life. And there has been pastors that have beat people up and bullied people to try to get them to give money. And there have been people that have misunderstood and been hurt and walked out of the church. And the whole purpose of this today, for all of you that are tithers, I know that you're like, amen, hallelujah. But for those of you that are on the fence and just don't really understand or really don't believe in that and everything else, this may be a little bit hard for you today, but the reality is if we can embrace the truth of what God's Word says, there is a tremendous blessing that goes beyond money. Can I say it again? It is beyond money. But what we have made it about, even as the church and even as ministers, we've made it about money, and it goes beyond money. But money is important, because even as I said it earlier before, that Jesus said, the Scripture says that you cannot serve both God and mammon. And the tithe is this, it is 10% of all your increase. It is the first 10%. Some people say, well, Pastor, should I tithe on the gross or the net? And I say, that's up to you. Do you want a gross blessing or you want a net blessing? It's really up to you. I'm not going to tell you how to tithe and when to tithe and everything else. That is between you and the Lord. And some people say, well, do I just have to tithe off my paycheck? Or, man, I got $100 for my birthday. And I'm like, that's between you and the Lord. But my Bible says all the first of my increase. So when I get a birthday gift, I pay a tithe on it. If I get a tax return, some of you have to pay. We all have to pay taxes. But when you get a tax return, I pay a tithe on it. Well, didn't I pay a tithe on the gross of my income so I don't have to pay a tithe on this tax return? That's between you and the Lord. But as for me and my house, every bit of increase that comes into my house, I am returning a tenth back to the Lord. Well, what if I don't show up for church next week? I guess I don't have to pay my tithe. Well, that's between you and the Lord. But you know what? He blessed me that week, and even though I didn't show up to the storehouse, the tithe still belongs to the Lord. I can tell you that all throughout my life, when I got a revelation of this, have there been struggles in my life? Absolutely. But I look back and I say that, you know what? Thank God He saved me from this. Maybe it was from me being obedient in this area of my life. Maybe it was just His mercy or His grace. But I'm here to tell you that I'm not going to take a chance in my own ability. I'm going to get hold of the Word of God and I'm going to walk it out to the best of my knowledge. Why? Because He said, listen, try me now in this, if I will not open up the windows of heaven, if you've got the right president. No, that's not what He said. If you've got your favorite person in office. No, that's not what He said. He said, if the stock or the Dow Jones is this or that. No, that's not what He said. He said, you try me now in this and see if I will not open up the windows of heaven, that even all throughout the Bible, that God would bring water from a rock if He needed to. He would feed people from birds and ravens that would bring them what they need. I'm here to tell you that we serve the same God today, and that if we will get in covenant with Him in the area of finances, it does not matter what happens in this natural world, God will make sure you are taken care of. This is not the book of Michael. This is the book of God. This is not just something made up. This is the Word of God. Tithing is returning the first 10% of our income to the storehouse. You know what's amazing? What's amazing is sometimes we can think because we do a certain thing, we're okay because I'm using my gift or I'm doing this. But let me tell you, you want the blessings of God in every single area of your life. And tithing is when we return the 10% of our income to the storehouse. And it's amazing to me. How do I say this? It's amazing to me how people can draw from a well but never give back to replenish. I want you to think about that for a moment. Always drawing and drawing, but never replenishing. Listen, I understand that if you've been through an abusive situation and you just need to come and sit and receive and be healed. But when people can come and have their life blessed in any place, I'm not just talking about here, but can never give back, can never sow, can never serve. Oh, I can't do that. I don't got time for that. My business is this. My life is this and that and everything. But never sow back and give back. I'm talking beyond just a natural thing. I'm talking the spiritual wells. You wonder why? Like, we've talked about spiritual wells before, but there are spiritual wells that need to be redug. There are spiritual wells that can gush with the provision and the blessing of God, but our spiritual wells have become so shallow. They've just become so shallow that church is just a thing that I check off, and if I want to read my Bible this week, I can. God understands and God knows. And, you know, I know I've got this thorn in my flesh and I got this little hiccup, and God understands my issue and my problem. But you know what? We diminish the blood and the power and the Word of Christ to continue to live with something that's holding us in bondage. That we need to grab hold of the fullness of the Word of God and say, you know what? I'm going to sow financially. I'm going to sow with my gifts and my talents. I'm going to do everything that I can do to redig these wells so that these wells will flow with the provision and the blessing that God has always intended. But you know what? Wells get contaminated. They get contaminated with hurt. They get contaminated with church hurt. They get contaminated with misunderstanding. They get contaminated with, I don't know if I really believe that word or not. You know what? Apparently, a lot of people didn't believe that word that came from the Lord. But the Lord said, why don't you just go ahead and try me and test me in this? This is the only place in the Bible. There may be somewhere else that I haven't seen because I don't know everything. But you know what? This is the place in the Bible that I see where the Lord says, why don't you go ahead and test me in this? Why don't you go ahead and bring your tithe and test me in this? Come on, you may not believe it, but why don't you just take the next few weeks? Why don't you take the next few months? And why don't you just put your faith out there a little bit in the word that I'm speaking to you? And he says, see what I will do. You bring your little 10% and see if I will not open up the windows of heaven for you and pour out blessings that there is not room enough to receive it. Why? Because we obeyed the word of the Lord. 10%. Tithe. Some people a little here, a little there when I feel like it. It's not being obedience in the place. It's not obedience in the place of the tithe. Leviticus 27:30 says this, and all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed or of the land, or the fruit or of the tree, is what? The tithe is the Lord's. It is the Lord's. And he says this, it is holy to the Lord. Listen, we can't give what we don't have. We can't give what we don't have. No one can give what they do not have. And that's why the Bible says that we return. We actually don't give tithes. We say that a lot. But according to the scripture, we return the tithe because the tithe belongs to the Lord. It's the first. It's the first 10% of all of our increase. It belongs to the Lord. So every 100 I get, every 100 the Lord gives me, he allows me to take 90 and be a steward over it, but to return the 10 unto him. It is the 10% that we return to him. And I just said a long time ago, I don't want in my house what belongs in God's house. I don't want what belongs in God's house, in my house. And so tithing is returning. It's bringing it back. I've used this illustration before, that if you've got a set of golf clubs that are very dear to you, or you've got a deer rifle that's very dear to you, or if you've got a Corvette or a boat and you let me borrow it, and I borrow it for a week and I go deer hunting and I shoot a deer with your gun, or I drive your Corvette around and look like that I'm whatever, you know, and I use your boat or whatever it is, and after I use it, you have given that thing to me to use for a day, a week, a hunting trip, or whatever it is. And if you give that thing to me to use, and then whenever I get done with it, I put a big bow on it, and I say, hey, I know next week's your birthday, I just wanted to give you this deer rifle. You would say, you done lost your mind. The only reason you got that deer rifle is because I let you use my deer rifle. I'm the one that paid for that. I'm the one that, you know, and so the same thing with the tithe. We cannot give anything that don't belong to us. The Bible says that we are to return the tithe. Do you know we actually don't give until we give over the 10%? Tithes and offerings. Tithes and offerings. See, what does tithing do? Can I give you personally what tithing has done in my life? Because there's been times in my life where I'm like, oh my gosh, am I really gonna do this? Thank the Lord, not anymore. I'm talking about early on when I first was trying the Lord now in this. When I'm trying to teach my children the principle of giving and sowing. And they're like, what? And then they go to the other extreme where they don't want to give nothing. Now they're giving everything away. And I'm like, hold on. God didn't say you had to give it all away. You need to hear his voice and give. I just bought you that last week. Don't give that away. No, I don't stifle their giving that way. But sometimes it's like, wait, you are way to the other extreme right now. And so you're trying to find this balance in this thing of giving with your children. But you know what? You know what? Even early on, it was sometimes a challenge when things were tight and you feel just financially strapped and you don't know what you're going to do. It's in those times that the devil will try to keep you from releasing what belongs to God. And even above that, I've seen people that said, you know what? I just... Man, it's going to be tough for me to support a child. And I'm saying, well, you don't have to support a child. I'm not telling you you have to support a child. And they're saying, you know what, it's going to be just a challenge for me to get my own children. But Pastor, I really feel like the Lord has spoken to me. And they support a child. And then out of the blue, they get a tremendous blessing. They get a bonus from their job that they didn't even know that they were going to get for Christmas. There's testimony after testimony of things that happened, not because a pastor told somebody to do something, but because somebody for themselves discerned the voice of the Lord and understand the principle of first and giving God first and ministering. God always meets the needs in our life. So early on, it's hard to release. Sometimes, but you know what tithing taught me? It taught me to put my faith in God, not in my own ability. Sometimes, for people, tithing and this principle of first, sometimes it's scary. Sometimes you can have a minister barking about tithing, maybe kind of like I'm doing this morning, barking about tithing, but you feel scared. You feel, oh my gosh, how can I do this? And some people are just afraid. But what tithing does, it causes you to put your faith in God. And what it does is when you trust Him and put your faith in Him, you will see Him come through. And it builds your faith for bigger things. Can I just say something, y'all? For those of you that are a part of this house, for those of you that are watching online, that are a part of this assembly here, we have to believe God for bigger things. Not for the sake of bigger things, but because there are souls out there that need to be reached. And it takes finances to do that. It takes resources to do that. It takes people with a willing heart to do that. And what we need to do is not be beat down under the circumstances. Well, look at the church now. COVID ain't half the people here anymore. And I don't know this and this ain't going to happen. No, we need to realize that our faith is not in the circumstances or the number of people that are sitting in chairs or joining online. Our faith is in God, that if He can change the world with 12 disciples and one of them betrayed Him, how much more can God do through a group of people that will get their eyes and their faith on God and begin to lift the limits off of what we believe and believe God big? Sometimes, can I be honest? Sometimes I feel like I'm alone believing God big. And that's not have anything to do with you. I understand that we're in a spiritual war, but sometimes I'm wondering, does anybody else believe in the vision of the Bible? Does anybody else believe in the importance of prayer? Does anybody else believe in holiness and pursuing the Lord? Does anybody else believe that we're really supposed to be a church without walls? Does anybody else believe it? Because I can't carry everybody, that we are to carry each other through the power and the grace of God and be who God's called us to be. I'm just asking the Lord to wake us up to who we are and to realize that together we can see the kingdom of God come and His will be done. Amen. Thank you. And the enemy fights overtime to get us weak in faith, little in faith. What does He say? He says, bring all your tithes. This is the principle of the first. Bring your tithe. Bring it into the storehouse. Because when I don't return to God what belongs to God, I put more faith in myself than I do God. That's a sobering thought if you think about it. It's either you don't believe the Word or you don't trust God. And if we don't believe the Word, we really don't trust God. It's easy sometimes to pick and choose what we want to believe, and there's a lot of confusion that's tied around sowing and giving and the tithe. And when I don't return what belongs to God, I put more faith in myself than I do God. Because the reality is, I already said this, but tithing is not just financial blessings. It's not. It goes beyond. Because the reality is 90% with God is more than 100% without God. If there's anywhere I want God, it's in my marriage, It's in my family. It's in my finances. Why? Because I've got to take care of my family. I've got to take care of my children. I've got to be a responsible father and an adult. I've got to be a responsible human being, you know. And I want to be in covenant with God in the place of my finances, in the place of my health, in the place of my marriage. And tithing is me building my faith that God will do what He said He would do. Tithing also does this. I'm not gonna not say it. Tithing provides for God's work through the local church. Listen, I am grateful. I am grateful for the givers and the tithers. I'm grateful for the non-givers and the non-tithers. Why? Because you are very valuable and you are very important. I don't throw people away because they don't sow financially or they don't tithe. I don't throw people away. I don't say, well, you're not this and you're not that. But the reality is that God does what He does in the local church through the tithes and the offerings. Your tithes and your offerings provide for the work of God through the local church. They do. It's the way God intended. It's the way that it works. Sunday doesn't happen if there's not tithers. Wednesday, outreach, the outreach that we did to sow into our community and all the outreach we do, the ministries that we sow into, it's not because of me, it's because of us. It's because of the faithful giving and the tithing. It's because of people sowing and being obedient to God. It causes the work of God to go forth and to go on to fulfill His plan and His purpose. That's why when you tithe and you give, we take 10% off of the top, because I personally believe in tithing. I tithe, and I believe as an organization, as a church organization, we should tithe off of everything that comes in. So we take 10% off. I don't ask anybody to do what I'm not doing. But I just begin to think, man, what if, I know I've talked to pastors, they say it's impossible. You can't have 100% tithing. There's just no way you can't have 100% tithing. And I'm like, with God, all things are possible. And if we had 100% tithers, imagine on the percentage of tithers that we have right now, because we ain't nowhere near no 100%. And I'm grateful for the tithers and the givers that we have. God has even blessed our tithers and givers in a greater way. And you may be sitting here today, well, I'm not a tither or a giver, but man, I'm blessed. Well, how much more blessed could you be if you got in covenant with God? How much greater could it be if you really got in covenant with God? He would blow your mind. He would absolutely open up the windows of heaven. And you know what? Where we can give at a certain point to 66 children, wow, what if we doubled that because people were tithing and giving? Why? Because it provides for the local church to do the ministry throughout the earth. And tithing does this. It taught me to put God first in everything. In Matthew 6:21, it says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. It teaches me to put God first. It requires faith to say, you know what, when I get paid on Friday or the 1st or the 15th or the 31st or the 30th or whatever day that I get paid on, that the first thing that comes out of my pay is what belongs to God. God, this is yours. And the rest, God blesses and multiplies. Teaches me to put Him first because the enemy brings confusion. He brings so much confusion about the tithe. We've already said, is it under the law? Is it this? Is it that? And actually, the tithe predated the law. If you go to Genesis chapter 14, you can see the tithe predated the law. It was a part of their custom as serving God, that a tithe of everything went back to God. It was a principle that they lived by, that they realized, the reason I got this paycheck is because God blessed me with health this morning and this week. The reason I got this is because of the favor of God. I should have been dead years ago, but because of the favor and the grace of God. There is a mentality and there is a mindset. And even the people in Abraham's day, Abraham gave a tithe to God before there was ever a law. This is Genesis 14. He even went to sacrifice his own son. I'm not saying that's a tithe. I'm just saying that he was so obedient to God that he went to sacrifice his own son, that it was such a custom and a part of their culture. I often begin what Isaac was thinking. Maybe he fought, but I don't see anywhere in the scripture. He went with his father. He trusted his father, and he went to that place. It is the highest form of faith to be able to trust God. And it was such a custom in their day and a part of their culture that even their children understood that a tenth of everything we get belongs to God, because the only reason we're here is because of God. It's crazy in our society today, because it seems like the biblical values and the traditions continue to diminish and diminish and diminish and diminish. There's no holiness in the church no more, and whatever. I believe part of that, but I don't believe all of that, and on and on and on. And we wonder the state that we're in. The tithe is actually, I believe, the scripture teaches us that the tithe is actually a principle. It's not a law. In Matthew 23 and 23, this is the New Living Translation, it says, For you are careful to tithe even the tiniest income. And I've had people argue, well, you know, the New Testament don't really talk about tithing, Pastor. And I say, well, in their day, they probably didn't have to talk about tithing because it was such a part of their lifestyle. And listen, there are people that give tithes religiously. If you hear anything today, hear this. It's about the heart. Because there are people, even the religious people, gave tithes religiously. They gave tithe and they offered prayer, but it was out of a religious duty. It was out of a religious obligation, a religious duty. It wasn't out of relationship. You know why I tithe? Not because I have to, but because I want to. Because I see that it is a principle that God has given us, and it's not just a law. And people have argued, well, you know, the New Testament don't really teach about tithing. And Jesus mentions tithing here, and I believe that he mentions tithing because it was, and you can probably argue this with me and everything else. I don't argue about it. This is just my personal belief, that it was such a part of the custom of that day that they honored God with their tithe. And he didn't really have to talk about it a whole lot, but it shifted from even the law to grace. And I don't even believe the tithe was really a law. Yes, it was incorporated into the law, but it predated and preexisted the law because it is a principle. And he says, for you are careful to tithe even the tiniest of your income from your herb gardens, but you ignore the more important aspects of the law, justice, mercy, and faith. You should tithe, yes. He says, yes, you should tithe, but do not neglect the more important things. And some people say, see, this is more important than tithing and everything else. And no, it's not this or that. It's this and that. In walking in this place of wholeness with God. And he says, yes, you should, but don't do that out of religious duty and neglect the other things. See, it's about relationship. It's about a relationship with him. And what you do with what you have reveals what you believe about God. What you do with what you have reveals what you believe about God. The reality is, there is no condemnation in Christ. There is no condemnation in this house. But if God is speaking to you today through his word, which God is always speaking, hear his word and obey him. Why? Because he will never leave you nor forsake you.